thank you everyone for coming and here this evening to discuss presentations. The main point we want to discuss tonight is doing presentations in English, of course. And so I'm not going to discuss any particular presentation. Rather, I want to give you a technique for doing presentations in general. Just a general technique you can always use for any presentation, almost anywhere you are, in any circumstance and any time. The presentation technique is based on a technique that you learned when you were children. In other words, you already know the technique. The only thing is, now you have to become more conscious of this technique and be able to apply this technique deliberately in your adult life, in a corporate environment or whatever environment you are in. That technique is called storytelling. Who has never told a story? Please put the hand up. Who has never told a story? Because if you don't know, then it will be hard for you. So everyone here has experience telling stories. Is this correct? All right. And that is going to be our paradigm, our framework. This here, this here is the storytelling paradigm. It's the same everywhere in the world, for every culture. It's the same framework. I'll discuss it in detail as we go through. So that's the what we're going to do is storytelling. Why? Why am I choosing this technique? All right. I'll have to answer it myself. There are many reasons why. And some of the reasons are, as I said before, what's the first reason for using storytelling as a technique? Everyone knows the technique. Everyone can use the technique. Most importantly, everyone understands the technique. And when we think about how human beings learn, because we're not just looking at it in terms of a particular context, we're looking at it in general, how human beings learn, how we learn. And we know one of the major ways we do learn is through storytelling. If you tell, everyone knows the story, I've heard it in Russia, of the boy who cried wolf. And from that story, we learned something. And so that's the idea of doing presentations in the form of a story so that we learn something. All right. The question is, though, in terms of this is the standard structure. The first question, actually, and the most important question, is where do we begin the story? Where do we start? Where do we start a story? Huh? At the beginning, yes? Oh, all right, makes sense. And where is the beginning of the story? So the idea is we begin the story at the end. Yes? In other words, we must know what our goal is. This is the first thing. We can't start the story unless we know what the goal is. So, for example, I started this story with you tonight. You're here tonight, and I'm telling you a story about how you can become competent presenters in English. After you leave here, you'll have a basic idea on how to proceed in doing presentations. So this is what I want to achieve. I want you to be able to do your own presentations when you leave here. And the question is, do you want the same thing? Because if we want different things, then it's going to be, it won't be so much fun. So who wants to be able to do their own presentations? Show of hands, please. All right. So that's clear. Everyone wants to be able to do their own presentations, and that's what we're going to focus on. The idea is, remember the stories you told and you tell in your everyday life? That's the technique, except we're going to use it for presentations. First. Next, we do know, though, that when we are telling stories, especially folk tales, if we ever listen to a storyteller, a good storyteller, or five good storytellers, and they might tell us the same story, but do they? But they tell it each in a different way. Have you noticed that? Why is that? Why? Think to yourself, why do you tell stories, maybe the same story, to five different people in five different ways on the same day? All right, we say no plan survives first contact with the enemy. What does that mean? No plan survives first contact with the enemy. What does that mean? What do you think it means? All right. That's exactly right. You hit the nail on the head. Nothing ever goes as planned, ever, ever. So we have our framework, yes, we do our plan, so we know what we want to talk about, we know what we want to say, but what's the key to the successful presentation? So what's the word we're looking for? One word? React is not, I don't like the word react. I like the word more respond. I don't like react. You know why I don't like react? I'll tell you why I don't like react. So are you a man or a dog? Here's the dog, yes? The car is driving down the road. And what does the dog do? Barks. 100 dogs, 100 cars, the dog barks. That's react. React is an instinct. Respond is a man. What does a man do? A man responds. What's the difference between react? React is an instinct, and respond is a?
Conscious activity.
Conscious activity? And what activity is it?
Intellectual.
Huh? Intellectual activity? We have a word for it. One word for this intellectual activity that humans engage in, that differentiates humans from dogs. One word.
Imagination.
I like the word imagination. I like the word imagination because the storytelling is all about imagination. Huh?
Flexibility.
I like that word.
Is it about the choice? To react,
not react. Exactly. Choice. Think. Huh? Think. That gives us choice, that gives us imagination, that all of these things come from thinking. So no plan survives first contact with the enemy, and the only way we're going to be successful is if we are flexible. That's what we need to remember. So this is a framework, but it doesn't mean it's play by play. It doesn't mean you do this, and then you do this, and you do this. It just means this is the general direction you go in. Yes? All right. So Now, I said here that we're talking about, story. Question is, how are we going to do our story? And the point I made is that we're always going to use this technique. It's going to be the same way. The first thing we need to do is, well, what's the first thing we need to do for our story? Well, remember, we need to know where we are going. Yes, we need to know what we want to say. Yes, what the outcome will be. So the first thing we need is a main idea. We'll call this main. I put main idea here because it's right. But just so that it fits with the S, I'll call it a subject. This is the sketch. This whole thing is the sketch. So we are breaking it down. Yes? This is the sketch, and now we are showing you the points on the sketch. Yes? Point by point. So the first point we need is a subject. What is the subject of tonight's presentation? Yes.
How to make a
Yes. So you are right, because a public presentation includes presenting yourself. You can't do a public presentation separately from yourself. Yes? So this is true. So subject is public presentation. Yes? That's our subject. And then we have a T. The T we shall call treasure. We call it treasure because what is treasure?
Knowledge.
I like that. Treasure is knowledge. Can we also add
some key secret?
All right, you said key secret.
It's something very valuable that you want to possess.
Valuable. All right, let's agree with everything you said, and let's ask ourselves, what is the treasure that you hope to obtain from this class? What is the treasure? Because we have to have an idea. What is the treasure that we are looking for? In a presentation, I mean, in life, some people can walk around and say, well, whatever comes my way, I'll take it. But in a presentation, it has to be more structured, more conscious. We need to know what we want. What do you want? Can you give that skill a name?
Skill of making presentations.
All right, that's okay. So public presentation is the topic, subject or topic. Yes? The treasure, what we want, the objective, what you, the audience, wants to achieve. Yes? Is the ability to do your own presentations, right? All right. So, then we have the O. So we did the S, we did the T, and now we're going to do the O. The inner story. For example, Little Red Riding Hood. Who knows Little Red Riding Hood? Everyone knows Little Red Riding Hood. All right, so tell me some of the main characters in that story. The wolf. Very good. Perfect. And the wolf represents what we would call in English an archetype, a character that is present in almost all stories and certainly should be present in your stories. Whenever you tell a story, make sure there's a big bad wolf in the story, because people love stories with big bad wolves. Yes? There has to be a big bad wolf, because why do we need a big bad wolf? Right? So, who else is in the story besides the big bad wolf? Who else is in the story? Right. So, exactly. So, we must have good and we must have evil. It's no fun if there's only good, because if there's only good, then there's no story.
And what about natural side, like hunter? He's not either good or neither evil.
He's the what does the hunter do? In because they're different versions. So what does your hunter do?
Put out Granny.
He saves Granny.
Yeah.
He saves Granny. Fine, but what does he do? Okay, you call it his job, but he saves the grandmother, yes? That's, so he's not weak, he's not evil, is he? The wolf is evil. He's not evil. So he's on the side of good. Maybe he's not the major character, so we have different, we have very good, we have major characters. Little Red Riding Hood is a major character. The wolf is a major character, and we have minor characters. This is the same thing. We'll look at it in a while, then we'll get to the next slide.
Sorry.
Go ahead.
Looking from that side, it seems mom is evil too, because she sent her daughter to the forest where wolves are.
Well, you know, we can look at the story from different angles, and we can say, remember, any story, anytime we tell a story, all stories, there's going to be, normally you'll have one, we call him here's the obstacle. We'll call the obstacle villain. This is the obstacle, villain. Villain means evil doer. Someone who is the big bad wolf is the villain, the obstacle. And this is the obstacle that the hero must overcome in the story. It creates tension in the story. So I'm going to answer your question, yes? But I just want you to think about the idea of tension in the story. The obstacle, what happens when there's what happens if there's no tension in a story? Boring, and then what? You doze off. That's exactly what happens. Yes? So that's why we have obstacles, because in teaching, we don't want people to doze off, so we have to add obstacles to keep it tense so that they remain focused. Yes? So I'm going to answer your question. All right. So an obstacle would be a villain. But here's the thing about it. Who is the villain? Who is the villain? For me, the wolf is the villain. But when the wolf looks at himself, does the wolf walk around and say, I'm a villain, I'm a bad person, I'm very bad? What does the wolf say?
He's just hungry.
Exactly. So he's just doing his thing.
It's his business.
You're right, that's his business. So from what we learn, this is the answer to your question. Every villain is the hero of his own story. Yes? So the villain is only the villain because we are not looking at the story from the villain's point of view. We are looking at the story from the hero's point of view. So from the point of view of Little Red Riding Hood, the wolf is the villain because We are telling the story from her point of view. So when you tell a story, you tell a story from a certain perspective, a point of view, and the perspective or the point of view you choose, that person or that circumstance is the hero. It's just like, for example, let's say, just to illustrate the point, yes? We are a company, and we're looking at our sales report for the previous quarter. And in the previous quarter, some competitor took a share of the market that we used to have. Now we have lost market share. We've lost market share. So from our perspective, who is the competitor? He's the villain. But the competitor doesn't walk around and say, I'm a villain. The competitor is looking at us, and who are we from the competitor's point of view?
Losers.
Well, we used to be the villain. Now we're losers. Yes? So he's the hero. Yes? So this is the point. We can discuss back and forth, but we need to decide on a point of view, and that's the point. From our point of view, we are always the heroes. Yes? All right. So the question is, who is the villain in our story?
Scare.
Huh?
Scare.
Fear?
No. The scare. Our own scare, for example.
Fear.
Fear?
Fear. You are afraid. Scare is normally we use it as a verb. Yes, we can use it also as a noun. The scare or to scare. But the more appropriate verb noun in this case would be fear. I think there's a very famous, I think it was Eisenhower, President Eisenhower. You might have heard of him during World War II. And he had a very famous line. He said, as a general Eisenhower in any case, he said, there is nothing to fear but fear itself. Make sense? So he didn't say nothing to be scared of. Fear is a better word. So we'll call one villain could be fear. Very good. Are there any other villains in our story? What we're looking at are obstacles. What is stopping you from achieving or from getting your treasure? What is stopping you? What's in your way?
Laziness.
we'll use a different word. We'll use a kind word. In English, we like to use kind words. Remember that, yes? We'll call it inertia. It's the same thing, but it's kind. It sounds nicer. Yes? So we have two villains. We need one more villain in our story. Lack of experience. Experience is a hero. Yes. So we will add experience, but experience is a hero. Yes. Lack of experience is a villain. Or lack of experience, yeah, we'll call it lack of experience. All right, so, and the next question here is, we're talking about, so we did the STO, and now we're going to do the RY. The RY, we're going to do what the right lesson. So, for example, the little boy who cried wolf too many times, what did he learn? What did he learn? What did the little boy learn at the end of the story? All right. All right. That's what he learned. And when you are telling your presentations, when you're doing your presentation, you also want your audience to learn something. Yes? In my case, what do I want you to learn? What's the lesson I want you to learn? Not just the skill, but the lesson. The skill we already identified, that's the treasure. But what's the lesson that we need to learn? What did, what's his name? I said Eisenhower say. I told you. What did Eisenhower say?
No fear, your own fear.
Yes, there is nothing to fear but fear itself. Yes? So that takes care of fear. In other words, no fear. Just don't fear. Fear itself is a waste of time. Lack of experience. How are we going to deal with this villain? What's the lesson we're going to learn here?
Practice.
All right. Practice make, we say in English? What's the lesson? Practice makes perfect. That's exactly the lesson we need to learn. Yes? What does that mean for you? Could you repeat, please?
Don't be afraid to make mistakes.
This is true. Very good. Don't be afraid to make mistakes. In fact, I will take it one step further. I will say, if you do not make mistakes, you're not learning anything. You're wasting your time. In other words, make a lot of mistakes. That's what I would say. I wouldn't say don't be afraid to make mistakes. I would say make a lot of mistakes. But here's the point. Try to make the mistakes in practice. When you are here, I'll move it up. We have a nice word for this. One thing you see, English has lots of nice words. So we have a word practice. Practice is clear, but here's another word. Look at this beautiful word. It means the same thing. It's a very nice word. Do you know what? It means practice. Yes? But if you see, re means what? Again. So again. Again or again. And then here's the key. Here. So not only do again, mechanical action, but say again. And in theater, they call practice, in theater, they call it rehearsal. In other words, say it again and again. That's how you learn Russian. That's how you learn your native language. You just say it again and again and again. And what happens if we... After a while, what happens? When we say it so many times?
We say it automatically.
Exactly. So we have a phrase for that in English. What's the phrase? We know it by heart. You hear and hear and hear, and then you know it by heart. And the idea is you should know your story by heart. Yes? So if you have to do a, this is the rule of thumb that know it by heart. For a presentation, rule of thumb. Rule of thumb is the same thing as a, equals a general rule, yes? This is just an idiom. Rule of thumb for presentations, they say if you are going to speak for 1 minute, you should rehearse for 1 hour. So if your speech is 10 minutes, then your rehearsal should be 10 hours. Does that sound very practical to you? You can do that? All right. What helps me, I'll just tell you my technique. Sure, rehearse for 10 hours, but I also find just thinking about it is like rehearsal too. Yes? So you're not actually doing it constantly, but just have it on your mind and think about it as you go through your day. That's also rehearsal. Yes? So thinking is also rehearsal. All right. So, and we will just wrap it up, the idea of the story, by answering some questions such as why. All right. Why stories inspire? It's clear. Let me think of an inspirational story. Can anyone think of an inspirational story? Some story that has inspired you? Ah, here's a story I learned. Look at this. In school, I, like everyone else, I wasn't someone who knew everything. But some things I never forget. And the things that I never forget are stories. Some story that someone that we learned in school. So I remember when I was 10 years old, and here's a story I learned. And up to today, I haven't forgotten this story. It goes like this. I thought I was poor because I had no shoes until I saw a man who had no feet. Just look at that. Just one sentence, and many, many years later, I haven't forgotten it. What's the lesson that I could have learned from that story? Or what's the lesson that we might learn from that story?
To value your life.
Value your life. All right. I'll write this down. And this is a story for you too, yes? I thought I was, because I hear people complaining, and where I come from, they say, do you have feet? You have feet? So what are you complaining about? You have nothing to complain. That's the point. You have nothing to complain about. This is the point. Value your life. And it's a good story. You have nothing to complain about. So we'll call this inspiration, yes? Because inspiration. In the 21st century, here's the point. We used to tell stories. When did human beings start telling stories? This is the question. How old is the oldest story, do you think?
From the beginning of existence of humanity.
Boy, we've been telling stories. It's part of our evolution, isn't it? You can't separate us from stories. In fact, in the 21st century, scientists say the human being is the storytelling animal. That's what we do. We tell stories, yes? So it's part of our existence, yes? Storytelling animal. Now, for example, I want to teach someone something. Yes? Someone should learn something from my experience. Here we are sitting around a fire 40,000 years ago. Yes? And maybe I'm a hunter. But not only a hunter, I'm a good storyteller. Think about it. So what story might I tell as the hunter? Yes, hunter will talk about hunting. What might you learn from this hunter, from the story the hunter tells? Exactly. Whatever. All of the, and these things, one question. Are these things important? How to run, how to hunt, is this important? How important?
It's about
survival. Do you see the point? And that's what stories do. Stories can be vital. We'll say in English. We'll use a nice word for you. Vitally important. Nice word. Vital. From Latin, which means life. Vita, life. Vitally important. Yes? So, what happened was between 40,000 years ago and starting maybe in the 19th century or so, stories were no longer in business. Our business environment, starting in the 19th century, especially in the 20th century, people said stories are not so important anymore in the 20th century. In the mid-20th century, stories were out of fashion in business environment. But now, in the 21st century, we understand they're back in fashion. Yes, because we have all of this information. Look at this. You have thousands here. You have facts. You have figures. And you have data. So you have millions of facts. Figures mean numbers, yes? Dollars, rubles, pounds, those are figures, yes? So facts, figures, and data. We have all of this. And you have a presentation. And you're going to present some facts, some figures, and some data. In the old days, up until the end of the 20th century, until the beginning, what you had happening was people would do what we call a data dump. Data dump, make sense?
Dump.
Mm-hmm. Well, I put big data here because that's a related story, but a separate story. So I put it here. I just want to say here.
Dump is like Humpty Dumpty.
Yes, it's like Humpty Dumpty. Humpty Dumpty had a big fall. So to dump something is, I'm a very practical person. You'll see this. Oops. We'll call this a dumpster. We'll call this a dumpster. You see them when you go to construction sites. You go to a construction site and there's a big dumpster somewhere. And what do you do with the dumpster? You dump waste into the dumpster. And so we've taken this concept of dumping, and we abstract it and use it as a metaphor in the case of data. And what we are seeing is you're looking at me and you are treating me like what? How are you treating me? What am I to you? Don't you, like sometimes there are people, they want to tell you all their problems. They just want to dump on you. Just want to come and just dump all their problems on you. What do you think? What do you say to that? I'm not your dumpster, right? Don't dump on me. It's the same thing. Don't dump your data on me. You have, for example, very good in business, you have price dumping. Exactly. Same thing. What is price dumping?
Make them less valuable.
Exactly. So you just dump the prices, yes? Exactly. So data dump is you just give me a lot of data, and the point about it is, go on.
It's in the file and it's unsystemized. It's out of the system, out of order.
Exactly. What would we say that? What would we say that? It's not structured. Mm-hmm. And if it's not structured, what's missing? Yes, and what do we call that? What are we discussing today? What's our topic today? Yes, and what's our technique? What's our technique for making a presentation?
Story.
So if it's not systemized, it's not structured, it lacks story. That's the whole point. Not systemized, not structured, no story. And therefore, if there's no story, and we have facts, we have figures, we have data, but we have no story, so you said human beings have been telling each other stories since, we would say, time immemorial. So long ago, no one remembers. Since time which means it's so long ago, no one can tell you how long ago. Since that's how long ago it was, since time immemorial. So, which means, if we think about it, humans and stories are like, we're even closer than humans and dogs. We say the dog is the human's best friend in the animal kingdom. The story is how we understand. Story gives meaning to facts and data. Yes? So story is how we understand. Story gives meaning to facts, data. What was the other one there? Facts, data, and figures, yeah. In other words, what does story do? So, who doesn't love dogs? I know some people say they like cats but not dogs, but I like cats and dogs. I like both of them. So, who doesn't like cats or dogs?
You mean keep dogs?
No, who doesn't like them? Who says, I don't like cats and I don't like dogs?
I don't like
them. You don't like cats. It's all right. But who doesn't like cats and dogs. Some people don't like cats or they don't like dogs. But most people like one or the other.
Maybe if you're allergic.
All right. So it could be. So, but the average person, has an affinity with cats or dogs. The human likes cats or dogs. So we call that an emotional relationship. That's the key. It's just a, we can't even explain it. It goes back to time immemorial. At some point, thousands and thousands of years ago, dogs became our friends and cats became our friends and they live with us. And stories are the same thing. So story gives meaning to facts, data, and figures. It emotionalizes them. Emotionalizes. That's the key. If that's the main point that you should learn. You need to emotionalize it.
You must present your presentation with emotions.
Mm-hmm. That's not enough. I can give a presentation with emotion. This is true. But that's only half. That's only me. But what's the key?
To get emotions from the audience.
React emotions.
Well, we left the word react back an hour ago. We said we're not going to use react anymore. When we talk about human beings, we don't like to, in English, especially business English, when we talk about human beings, we don't like to use the word react. React is Pavlov and his dog. That's react. Yes? For us, we are higher beings, and we do what?
Respond.
We respond. And so you are right. We are trying to get from you, or you are trying to get from your audience, what?
Response.
What kind of response?
Emotional
response. And story is the key to open the door called, there's a sign on the door, it's called emotional response. The key is story. Boom. That's it. Yeah? And the thing about it is, when I give you facts and figures and data, and you have to read that report, all those facts, all those figures, all that data, what happens? What happens? What happens?
The audience
dozes off. Because he, she, it. So you doze off. Yes? And the story, because it awakens in you or evokes an emotional response, it keeps your attention, and so you in what we would call, we'll give it a name, all right? And the idea is it appeals to all types of learners because human beings love stories. Go ahead. I'm listening.
Why do you like Hunter Robbins so much? I'm sorry, I'm just...
What's the question again?
I'm just curious, why do you like Capital Letters so much?
Capital, 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 capital. Yes? It's marketing English. In marketing English, we like capital letters. All right.
No,
so
for me, it looks like full of stripe marks.
It irritates you here. This is, I don't want to get off on a tangent, but this is related to your question and related to the idea of story. What's the first thing you want to do when you tell your story? This is the tech, we call this AIDA. This is a technique. Do you know this technique?
No. It looks like name of my aunt.
Does anyone know this technique? Yes. Do you know what it is? What it stands for? This acronym? So the first thing is attention. Yes? So, you know, do you know any brands? Here's the answer to your question. Do you know any brands? What brands do you know? One brand. Name one brand. Huh? Mercedes. KFC. Mercedes. Yes? All right. Those are a couple of brands. Why do you know these brands? Why do you know these brands?
It's abbreviation, KFC.
But why do you know these brands? This is the question.
Commercials and attractive logo.
All right, exactly. Because it's always, we would say in English, it's always in your face. In your face. Always in your face. In your face is a kind of a idiom. In a prominent position, yes? So you always see it, and you see it again and again and again and again. And after you see it 100 times, what happens? It's like a story. They're doing the same thing.
And then you're telling, I'm loving it.
Exactly. So it's their story. This is the only difference. They are telling you their story. And the key to telling your story, at least in marketing English, is to, again, repeat, put it in a prominent place and repeat. And then what happens?
You know it by heart.
And when you know the story, Mercedes story by heart, that's when Mercedes becomes what? Huh?
You just know about it.
Yes.
It's,
right. It becomes a brand. That is a brand. That is the meaning of the word brand. So, brand. So, I write like that because I'm branding. Yes? Brand simply means, if you think about the origin of the word brand, who knows German here? Some German. Brand means basically burn, fire. Burn, fire. So why would they call it a brand?
Maybe like a seal.
It's a seal, exactly. And where is it sealed?
On cattle.
All right, that's the origin on cattle. All right, on cattle. We live in a capitalist country, and so we are all cattle from the capitalist point of view, which means it's branded in your mind. Exactly. Branded, the story is branded in your mind. So, you're asking me why I'm doing this? Because I want to brand my story in your mind. Yes? Like the teacher told me when I was 10 years old, I thought I was poor because I had no shoes until I saw a man who had no feet. They branded that story in my mind. I've never forgotten it. That's why I do it. It's part of branding. Branding is a technique. That's good.
It touched something in your mind.
Very good. Yes, you are right. You are. I agree with you. It touched something, and that's what your story should do. So we get to the next point. Let's take what you said. We get to the point here of know your audience. That's where we're getting to. It's exactly the point. Yes. So you tell your story, but when you tell your story, you must know your... Do you want to take a break? Whenever you want to take a break. So, know what you said. Know your audience. I agree with you. Because some people talk about teaching, and they say, I'm going to teach something. And I don't really believe in teaching. I don't think you can teach. I think that's what you were saying. Because they didn't teach me anything. I learned something. Learning is active, it's not passive. Nonetheless, although you cannot teach, but maybe you can facilitate learning. How about this? And that's what you do in your presentation. You don't teach, but you facilitate learning. Go ahead.
Do you think about animals is all about learning to not about teaching? I mean, all those dogs and cats, rabbits and horses, isn't it about teaching?
Well,
how and what to do?
Well, I like what you said, but it's a kind of a strange logic because it leaves out some important points. But I'll take your argument. What I'll say is, first of all, with the animals, I'll use a different word. We use the word training. That's where the word training comes from. And you're right, you can train people too.
You told English.
You said animals. So yes, we can train animals. Yes, we can train dogs, we can train parrots, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And we use the same word. You are right, people are animals too, so we can train people. It's true. That's what Pavlov was teaching us. He was teaching us we can train people. Yes, so we can train people. And some people believe that's all you need to do is train people. Some people argue you don't need to do anything else with people. Train them, it's good enough. Yes? But what do we believe? These are the people that believe in reaction. They use the word react. People who use the word react, they believe you can train people. But people who use the word respond, people like me, what do we believe? We believe you can educate people. So we believe in education. So training is important to within a certain context. But when you want to reach maybe some higher abstract skills, then you have education. And education, if we know the literal meaning of education, what it means is pull to knowledge. That's what it means. It means guide you to knowledge. Educate means guide to knowledge. So, again, my point is if you talk about teaching in terms of training, that's a separate issue. But the issue that we are focusing on here is guiding to knowledge. We're okay with that? All right. But you said know your audience. That's really a very important part of your story here. All right. So this is the structure. Can you do the next one for us here, please? All right. So what I did with you, the first part, was what we call the exposition. This is in theater, in Hollywood, we call this the backstory. The backstory simply means the background. Backstory, another plain English word for backstory is context. That's all it is. Yes? And so whenever you do your presentation, the first step, once you know the structure, the first point in the structure is what? Which is, another word, the backstory, the context. Yes? And the context simply says who, when, where. That's all it is, nothing else. So nothing abstract. Who, when, where. So here we are tonight. What's our context? What's the who, what's the when, and where's what's the where of our presentation tonight? Or of our event, we'll call it that.
To learn how to do presentations in English, I gathered in Galician Hotel to gather tonight in Galician Hotel to learn this.
No, you know, it's important because if I don't know the who, when, and where, I don't even know what to do next. Yes, that's part of my context. So this is the first step. Yes. So the who will say people, and that's in our concrete case. In the case. In general, whenever you are doing a presentation, you will want to consider who, your audience. Yes? And we will just look at some aspects of audience that I would like to cover with you. Go ahead. Go ahead, please. No, you're right. We can go deeper and deeper and deeper, and then we can say, and this is mostly a Russian audience, et cetera. So we can go more detailed. It's fine. And maybe in some cases, the more detailed, let's think of a possible advantage of being detailed. What could that? Because if there's no benefit in it, this is business English. If there's no benefit in it, then what? Don't do it. That's the bottom line. No benefit, leave it alone. So if we're going to do this, then there must be a benefit. Question, what's the benefit of going into detail as you did?
Variable in this equation that if
he talks like this is how they talk. They make it look like it's mathematics, it's science. Yes, for them, it's science. Yes, they're not just talking, it's science for them. And this is exactly what they'll say. A key variable, we can remember this phrase, it's a nice phrase, in this equation. Just like in mathematics, yes? Perfect. The meaning is clear? Yes? Say this in plain English, please. No, it's very good. It's outstanding. That's why I put it on the board. But just say it in plain English so that I'm sure that it's clear to you. Or say it in other words. Well, what's another word? Okay, what's key? What does key mean? Key simply means important. A variable is element or component or part. Of this system, an important part of this, we'll call it approach. Yes? It's good to always have more than one way to say something because that shows also deeper understanding. Yes? And that's an important element, deeper of story. What is deeper understanding? What is it? You call it this system, or I'll leave it, approach. It shows deeper understanding when you can formulate it in different ways. What does deeper understanding mean? Because we use these words, but it's not good enough if we use the words and then we hear the words like the parrot hears a word and parrots the word, deeper understanding, deeper understanding. Does the parrot have a deeper understanding? No. But the parrot can say the phrase deeper understanding. Yes? And that's my point. You have a deeper understanding when you can rephrase it. And deeper understanding simply means, in plain English, different ways of looking at something. Nothing else. When you tell a story, if you have facts and figures and data, you might not have much understanding at all. But to tell a story requires deeper understanding because you are going to relate these facts and figures and data and you are going to give them meaning. Another definition for human. So I gave you one definition for a human, the storytelling animal. Different ways of seeing something. Yes? Another definition for the human being is, very simple, the giver of meaning. The one who gives meaning. Only humans give meaning. Yes? Because if you think about it, every human being almost that you know, what's one of the major questions we ask ourselves? We start when we are little, as soon as we become independent thinkers, what's one of the first questions we always ask?
Why
Why? What does it mean? Why are we here? Why are we not somewhere else? Why am I here? Why am I not there? Why am I this? Why? Because the human being has in our biology, yes, a need for meaning. We can't live without meaning. And that's where you get them with the story, because in the story, what are you doing? What are you doing with the story? If humans have a need for meaning, it's an
story is solving the question.
We're giving them an answer. Exactly. We're giving you meaning. Here's meaning for you. And people will say, wow, he answered my question. Tonight I have meaning, yes? The one who gives meaning. So, answer, story gives meaning. We okay? Go ahead.
We were talking about context, about who, when, and where. Is it about subject from story, abbreviation? Because we were talking about story and the abbreviation and left why. Without any meaning.
Is that it? Did the why without reason? I left why empty.
Yes.
You should have said something. Oh, that left you asking a question. Yes. Let me just look at my why here. Let me just look at my why. Why I have it here. Well, no, actually, I did answer the question why. The question why was, why story? This was the question.
It's about the last letter?
Yes. In other words, the why, we just turn, we do this in English. We play a lot, yes? So the why is actually why. And it's actually why story. We okay with that?
Yeah. By the way, about Aida also.
I didn't finish it?
Yeah.
All right. No problem. All right. So, attention. If you look at it, you walk anywhere and there are all of these, we call them commercial brands, not only commercial brands, also non-commercial brands, because brands can be a lot of things, yes? We know commercial brands, you can be a brand. So a brand can be just about any entity that is autonomous, any autonomous entity, meaning that thinks and acts on its own, can be a can seek attention. Yes. Now here's a question: why do we seek attention, in general or in a presentation? Why do we seek attention? Because remember, here's a question: why? And the storyteller, we always answer the question: why? Why do we seek attention? Well, if you're a business, if you're a Mercedes, to get feedback is correct. What feedback are they looking for? Yes, to get feedback. What feedback? So what I want to say is feedback is very generic. It's so generic, it really doesn't tell us what we're looking for. I mean, feedback, you could kick someone, that's feedback. Is that what you want? All right, so let's say, we'll take your word, we'll say positive feedback. What you said, we'll leave it, but we'll say positive feedback, because I can give you other feedback that's not positive, it's not what you want, yes? We okay with that? And you're right, love is positive feedback, yes? So, for a business, What is positive feedback for Mercedes? Huh?
Sales.
That's all it is. I mean, that's not all it is, but pretty much so. Sales. For a presentation, what's positive feedback? For your presentation or for my presentation, for any presentation, what's positive feedback?
Emotional response.
Well, I can be very angry. Arr, that's an emotional response. Huh? This is true. This is true. Actually, you are right. You know, do you know Benetton?
Yeah.
You know Benetton? Benetton, I don't remember when. Some years ago, they had some marketing campaign where they featured something that was very unattractive. When people saw it, they got very angry. And that was their marketing campaign. It's exactly what you said. They got very angry, but what's the but?
They reacted. No, they responded.
They responded, and therefore?
They remembered.
Exactly. So, very good point. That's why we get to the point here where, depending on who you are, some people... Depending on who, it depends a lot on your values. But there is the saying that there is no bad publicity. Have you heard this saying? Huh? Which kind of helps us understand why some people. Love to be, we say in English, we have the word notorious. Do you know the word notorious?
No.
All right, so let me just help you. So we're doing the A, yes? We'll do the I in a minute, one moment. So notorious. We have the word famous. Everyone knows the word famous, yes?
Yes.
Now, there's also the word infamous. Does anyone know the word infamous? No, it's not the opposite. Infamous is closer to notorious. We have some words in English, like here. To know. Here, let me give you an example. One moment. We have the word valuable. English has some words like this, valuable, and then we have the word invaluable. You have something in Russian similar, that's why I gave you this. No, valuable is what? And what's invaluable?
It's an outmoded price, yes.
Yes, it's a very, very high price. If the price is so high, we can't even name it. So it's not that it has no value, it's just that the value is very high. And infamous is the same thing as famous, but in a negative way. So this is positive. This is negative. And this is also negative.
Something like spam? No, I mean...
I see what you're saying.
Not about letters in a mail, but about ham in a can. Was it notorious when there was a campaign...
During which war? There are so many wars. Which war are we talking about?
In famous, it's a mean that famous.
famous for bad things. For example, Batman is famous for good things. You know Batman? And the villain in Batman, his arch rival, the Riddler. You don't know. The Riddler. Do you know? You don't know the Riddler, yes? You know the Riddler? The Riddler, we say, is villains are normally infamous or notorious. But we know them too. Therefore, in that point of view, there's no bad publicity per se. But Academe Consult would not like to be infamous or notorious. And why not? Because the Riddler is a villain. So the target audience for the Riddler are villains. He's selling to villains. There's a market for villains. But the target audience for Academe Consult are heroes. They're selling to heroes. So if your target audience are heroes, then you want to be positive. If your target audience are villains, then you want to be negative. You don't want to be good. It's like they say in English, it's good to be bad. Yes? If it's a villain. Does that make sense? All right. So One moment. All right. The I is simply interest. Whose interest are we talking about? Exactly. Who should be interested in the product or in the presentation? Who should be interested?
The audience.
Your target audience. Whether it's consumers or listeners or whatever, you want your target audience to be interested. Now, here's another. You see, for each of these, this is cool because it's a science. So each of these, you can break them down and you can come up with another acronym. This is the chief acronym. If you only learn one acronym tonight, this is it. This is the most important acronym to learn. The reason why it's the most important acronym to learn is because it's true everywhere in the world, regardless of culture. And this is how we try to do it. Try to make it scientific so that it's valid across all cultures. Yes? That's our approach, or our system. So here's we've done this before. If you know the United States, then you know that they have radio stations. They have like radio station WNBC, WABC, yes? And so this is to remind you of a radio station. And this, the name of this radio station that everyone in the world is listening to. What's the name of this radio station? Everyone in the world is listening to this radio station.
BBC.
Well, some people in the world listen to BBC. But everyone in the world, everyone, without exception. No, some people listen to the Voice of America. Everyone is listening to this radio station in China, in Russia, in Africa, in Asia, in North America. Everywhere in the world, everyone is listening to this radio station. What's the name? WIIFM. It's the radio station everyone in the world is listening to. And when we talk about interest, this is what you must do. So let's do the WIIFM for this class. What's in it for you? Why? What's in it for you? Because if there's nothing in it for you, you're not. This is the point is, this is the our thinking, yes? We talk about science. Our thinking is that humans make rational choices. Humans make rational choices. To put this is the same thing, but this is in a scientific way. But it's the same thing, yes? Humans make rational choices. What does that mean, humans make rational choices? So, in other words, you look for, here's the question. I want to give you a word, because I want you to keep this word. Like I didn't want you to use the word react, yes? Drop react, use respond. Now I want to give you another word. Remember this word, benefits. We look for benefits. That's the main thing. Everything, and this, for example, I could do a presentation and I can say, oh man, Peter, that's a very, very nice presentation. I really like that presentation. It has this, it has this. It's a nice, I can make a car. I can say, oh, it's a nice car. I can make a phone and say, oh, that's a nice phone. I can fall in love with my presentation or with my phone, with my creation. So I love the features. So I, or you as a presenter, yes, you can fall in love with, and there are lots of examples of this, even in literature, of people or artists that fell in love with their invention, with your creation. All right. So I love my presentation. Is it a good presentation? If I think it's good, is it good? No, no, for one. If I think it's good, is it good?
It's subjective
to. So when is my presentation good? Tell me, when is my presentation good? So for you, when is it good? Just because you put it in an abstract way. Just put it in concrete terms. When is this a good presentation?
If I learn something.
All right. If I have a benefit. And that's the key. So for your audience, when you're doing your presentation, it has to be, you must answer this question. Remember, we asked a big question. The question is, this is a question. Benefit, and the answer to this question is benefit. You must provide a benefit. If you don't provide a benefit, I like it. And you have hundreds of examples where companies have invented or developed products, and the engineers love the projects. Or love the product. I think there was GM did an automobile that they were very, very happy with. I think they had a team of about 50 engineers that developed a car. And they thought, the engineers thought it was the best car ever. And it failed. Because what was the problem? Well, the consumers didn't like it. That's bottom line. Consumers didn't like it. Consumers didn't think it had the right benefits. And it's over. Yes? So that's what we need to do. So that's the I. The I is not actually giving you the benefit. The I does what? What does the I do? Promises the benefit. And this is one of the greatest secrets of all, the promise. Yes? It promises a benefit. Because every business It doesn't matter what business it is. What are we selling? I'm selling one thing. Every business is selling one thing, and every customer is buying one thing. Or every presentation is giving one thing, and every member of the audience wants one thing. When you came here, there was one thing that you wanted from this audience or from this presentation. One thing you came with. Hope. Remember, Obama based his whole campaign on one word. He only did one word because he has scientists. These guys have billions of dollars. They have scientists studying the human creature. And what does the human creature want more than anything else? Hope. So he's selling hope. Yes? So you come here hoping that your needs will be satisfied. And I come here selling the hope that I will satisfy your needs. That's the product. Yes, my product. But of course, we say in English. Let me help you here. We do have hope on the one hand, but we also say, so the hope that I'm selling you, that we'll give the hope a name, we'll call it pudding. The name of my hope is, we'll call it shepherd's pie. Yes? Do you know what this means? What, could you tell me what it means, please? All right. Make sense? So, yes, first you buy the hope, but then you're going to open the package and look inside and you're going to try it out. Yes? And if it doesn't satisfy your needs, then what? What happens?
Hope is ruined.
You just go move on to the next one. Yes? Move on.
Huh? It turns into lies.
Turns into?
A lie.
A lie. Yes? So, hope, interest is hope, that there's just you will get a benefit. D is the desire. D is desire. What's desire? Another word for desire.
Wish.
I like the word wish. It's a nice word. But it's kind of almost like it's a reactionary word. Because I can wish anything. I can wish anything. I can wish I had $1 million. Do you see the problem with wishing? I can wish I had a fairy godmother. Yes, desire is closer to need. The thing about wish is abstract. I can wish I had $1 million, and I can go home and I'm happy. If I don't have $1 million, it's no big deal. So what?
But you say wish must be real in English, or you must have a real wish.
Well, the thing about it is what we make real are not wishes. Wishes are not what we make real. What do we make real? Desire, dreams. Yeah, because what are dreams? Dreams are desires. Exactly. Dreams are desires. Wishes are whatever. Yeah? Wish I could have a lamp, a magic lamp with Aladdin. I can rub the lamp and I can make a wish. So what? It's a fairy tale. But a desire is in this life. Wish is in the next life. Yes, I wish to go to heaven. That's what I wish. Okay? So desire is in this life. Does that make sense? Because in marketing, I can't work with your wishes. Your wishes won't make you into a customer.
What when they're doing designer, he make wishes in real
world? No, my point is, I can't appeal to your wishes. Your wishes are not good enough. It's not good enough. I need something stronger than wishes. To get, because after this, this is the second A. What's the second A? Action. Action. Wishes do not provoke action. Wishes don't make you act.
Or that means the desire is calculating.
You know, desire is a... desire, everyone knows has had some desire. What are things we desire to live a good life?
Well, something about passion.
Thank you. Desire is a synonym for passion. Passion and desire go together. Thank you. Passion. Wish has no passion in it. Wishes, if we're going to do something, I don't want on my team people who engage, and this is what we say, if I have a team, any kind of team, yes? I don't want to have on my team people who engage in wishful thinking. What's wishful thinking? What is that? All of you are here today because all of you are here today are demonstrating desire. Yes? Because you have actually taken action to come here to achieve a goal that you have set your sights on. Now, you would be demonstrating wishful thinking if you were sitting at home drinking tea and saying, I wish I could speak English. I can sit at home and say, I wish I could go to Russia. So desire is tied directly to action. So, and that's why in your presentation, you need to make sure, as we say, you evoke emotions, and the most important emotion is action is after this, after the emotion, because the emotion, desire, will then fuel the action. And this is the point. Desire fuels action. That's the second A. And desire fuels action. All right, let me just kind of do the next slide real quick. Let me, because I know we didn't. But all right, so look at this, man. Rising action and tension. So rising action and tension. We just discussed this is a competition of various desires. Because you have a desire, who else has a desire? Who else has a desire? You, as the hero of your story, you have a desire. Your desire is, for example, to do a good presentation. Yes? So that's a positive desire. But we can remember we talked about positive desire is action. Well, let's do a negative desire. A negative desire would be, just to get it, would be inertia. Do you see it? It's not taking you forward. And the thing about it is then we need to have some kind of tension. Different, these plot points simply mean here different reasons to do this. We already discussed the reasons why we are here. Those are plot points, yes? Let's do the next one. Ha. I know. I'll get it done. Here we come to the, hey, do you see that? We built up. We did everything. Now we're basically finished. This is it. What happens here? So we have a battle. We have a fight. We had a fight. And then what? Exactly. So this is the battle of good and evil. We must have this. Your story must have the battle of good and evil. Good can simply, evil can simply be the competition is taking away our market share. And goods can simply be we came up with a different strategy to change the course of the development and turn things around. And we won. Key, we won. Let's move on to the next one. What happens here? What happens here? What do we do here?
We understood that we've overcome the crucial point and the good has won.
And therefore, and what do we do? Relax. So falling tension, we unwind tension. So deliberately your presentation in the first half must build tension. Tension towards a crisis, we overcome in the crisis, and now little things. Yes, little things. What's the next little thing? The end. Basically, tying up loose ends. Actually, it just the end. It means it's a synonym. It means the last little things that we need to do to finish up the story. Yes. In other words, for example, in this case, let's say I want to finish up my story here. Yes. What would I need to do to finish up our story? All right, conclusion, yes? Conclusion, exactly. So what would be the conclusion of our story tonight? Help me write the story because it's your story too.
To sum up all the information you learned.
Well, this is the why. This is really the why. What did we learn? This is the final. Just the lesson. So we don't want to, you're right, sum up. But in English, for example, we like to sum it up in one sentence. So we don't want to give a lot of facts. We just want to use one sentence. So one sentence. What did we learn? What have we learned?
That
tonight. All right, go on. So what have we learned tonight? What have you learned tonight?
More successful.
That's very abstract, man. You see, we hate this abstract stuff. All right. So try to be a little more concrete, because this abstract stuff, no one understands it. It's like, It's in the sky somewhere. I can't use it. In English, nowadays, in the 21st century, we love tools. Give me a knife and I'll cut my way to heaven. That's what we say.
And we cut what?
Give me a knife and I will cut my way to heaven. Yes? But I need a knife. Well, I'll cut my way. This is the whole point. This is the whole point. Well, it doesn't matter if he lets me. I'm not going to ask him. So this is the point. So in other words, what we are saying in plain English, give me a tool. So the question is, what tool do you have for presentations? That's the only question. Well, you can't remember by heart, because if you try to memorize it by heart, then something is going to happen. You need to be a little more flexible. So I want to know the one tool that you should have. What is the knife I gave you tonight? I gave you a knife.
Steps of presentation.
All right. What did we call the knife? The knife I gave you. I gave you a knife to cut your way to heaven. Well, the desire you have in you, I can't give it to you. Yes?
Maybe a response?
Well, I think the knife I gave you was story, the story structure. That was it's very simple.
You give it a sketch?
Yeah, the paradigm. Yes. So use the story structure for your presentations. That is the knife that will, because in English, one more thing. I'm going to close with my favorite writer, Shakespeare, and a quote from Hamlet, where he says, "My words fly up, my thoughts remain below. Words without thoughts never to heaven go." Heaven. Words without thoughts never to heaven go. So where is this heaven? Huh? Heaven is your mind, all right? So the knife, of course, I don't want to use a knife to get into your mind, but I'm going to use, how are you going to get into the mind of your audience? Heaven is the mind. And we said words without thoughts. So words without thoughts, that's like when a parrot speaks, empty words. There's no thought, there's just a word. But humans use words and we... Words are the clothes for thoughts. Yes? So we clothe our thoughts in words. The question is then, when we use thoughts, we reach our goal. Yes? And therefore, reaching your goal, getting to heaven, reaching your goal, I gave you the story structure to reach your goal of good presentations. That's your knife. I know it's a little violent, but in English we'll have a lot of violent metaphors. But we don't mean it that way.
But yeah? You use nice words to render these metaphors.
Well, the thing about it for us, the basic point is if you remember, there's another guy. If you look at, for example, Shakespeare, he has many villains, great villains. The villains are really great. There's this one guy, Richard III. You might have heard of him. And he has two brothers. Yes? So Richard III is a really wicked guy. He kills both of his brothers. I think he kills his two nephews. his two nephews. He does a lot of wicked things. And then he becomes king. Yes? But this is not to say you have to go and do a lot of wicked things. But what we are saying is you have to be focused and you have to really have a strong desire. And not only a desire, you also have to take some action to achieve your goals. That's all they're saying. We okay with that?
Yeah.
All right, so give me a knife and I'll cut my way to heaven. You have your knife. Any questions?